Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the Open University's Elevate Equity Conference. Big hello to everybody joining us online. And of course, hello to all of you in the room. How are you all doing? Fantastic. I'm June Sarpong, and I am your host today. I'm super excited to be able to lead the conversations that we have going on throughout the day, all centered around equity and ensuring that we create truly inclusive workplaces. Equity is the process of acknowledging and responding to differences and finding ways to level the playing field. Inequity in the workplace manifests itself in different ways, and we're going to explore this throughout today's conference and also give you practical advice on how to elevate equity within your organization and workplace strategy. The first area we're going to discuss is about breaking down barriers during the hiring process to ensure that you are attracting the best possible talent from all walks of life and all backgrounds. It comes as no surprise that demonstrating a commitment to inclusion is increasingly important for attracting talent and needs to be matched by a process that doesn't further embed inequity into the workplace. The thing that I've found, and I think that Rachel, who's one of our panelists, is going to touch on this a little later, is that what doesn't get measured doesn't get done. And if you really want to be able to create true sustainable equity within your workplace, then you need the most accurate data possible. But in order to access that data, you also need to create the kind of environment that is truly, truly safe so that people do feel comfortable and confident in terms of sharing their authentic data with you. I also want to talk about the things that I've found that's worked in my career. I've found that having that designed intervention at the right time has made such a difference. When you understand the barriers that diverse talent face, and then you put in place structures to undo those barriers, you're able to really unleash opportunity and to help diverse talent thrive within your organization. I want to touch on some data that I think that you might find useful in your journey. Glassdoor found that 76% of employees and job seekers said a diverse workforce was important when evaluating companies and job offers. Recruitment Board Monster found that 62% of employees would turn down an offer if it came from an organization with a culture that didn't seem to support diversity. But as organizations struggle to recruit with deep-rooted skills and a deep-rooted skill shortage over the past few years, which obviously has been exacerbated by the pandemic, political and socioeconomic issues, how does attracting diverse talent now look in practice? To kick things off, we are going to start with a word cloud on our screens, and we're going to do that both with our live audience and with our virtual audience back home. So you can use your Slido code, so you should all be able to see your Slido code on your program. You can scan that. And for those of you that are watching online, the Slido code is on your screen. So what we'd like to know is, what does equity mean to you? What does equity mean to you? If you can answer that question, give us some keywords really describe what equity means to you, that'd be great. I'll be looking at some of the answers shortly. But while we give people enough time to respond, I'm going to bring in our fantastic, distinguished panel and allow them to introduce themselves and also, of course, answer this question. You guys didn't come here just to relax. We're going to put you to work. So, Gamil, I'm going to start with you first. If you can tell us about yourself and what you do, and, of course, answer the question, what does equity mean to you?
Thank you, June. And thank the Open University for allowing us to share our knowledge and experience with everybody. Mm. So I've been a diversity and inclusion strategist for 23 years.
Wow.
I spent 9 years heading up diversity practices for marketing, branding, recruitment, advertising organisations such as Penner and Havas. And 2005, I set up Diversity Marketplace, which is now a global diversity, equity and inclusion consultancy. We have a team of diversity analysts, strategists, auditors, researchers, trainers, facilitators, and we work across the globe and literally from Iceland to Australia and Chile.
Wow.
And things in between.
Fantastic.
We are very, very fortunate.
So you were doing it at a time where there really was no blueprint or template for it.
No.
You're a bit of a trailblazer.
Well, to be honest with you, I got involved very quickly. I got involved through somebody saying to me, you know, you've done work with the Commission for Racial Equality. Mm. You must know about diversity and inclusion. She said, how'd you like to come and set up our diversity practice?
Wow.
I said, no, thanks. I wouldn't know where to start. She said, don't worry, I'll help you. And I promise you that's how I got involved in diversity, equity and inclusion.
How fantastic.
But my answer to the question is freedom.
Oh. Yes.
Freedom to be me and who I want to be.
I love that freedom. Fantastic. I'm going to write that one down. Brilliant. Well, looking forward to chatting more with you and thank you for joining us today. So, Juma, if I can come to you next, tell us a bit about yourself, what you do, and of course, what equity means to you.
Thank you, June. Good morning, everyone. I'm Juma Johnson. I am Chief of Staff to the Vice Chancellor at the Open University and also Director of Development. So I look after our alumni who are spread across 171 countries of the world, all our philanthropic fundraising, and of course the Vice Chancellor. So within the Vice Chancellor's unit sits our EDI unit as well.
Yep.
And this has been part of the journey that we started about 3 years ago when we, as part of our response really to Black Lives Matter, realized that we needed to do a bit more work to get our own house in order.
Yes.
You know, we were saying earlier this morning, we don't know it all and no one's cracked it. There's plenty of work to do. We created that portfolio to take very deliberate intentioned action around what we could do as an educator, as an employer, and as a member of community. It's very hard to follow Gamil's introduction, so I'll pause here on who I am. But what does equity mean to me? If we're following the one word answer, I'd say empathy. I think it's really important that people are seen, are heard, and therefore we can do something in turn that is appropriate for individuals.
Fantastic. Brilliant. Rachel.
Yeah, so good morning, everybody. I am Rachel Huggins. I am a practice lead and head of race representation at Ordelis. So Ordelis is an executive search firm focused on diversity. Mm-hmm. We've been fighting the fight for 12 years now and really trying to challenge organisations and what they can do to improve representation across a number of diverse characteristics. And when I think about equity, to me, it's that recognition that everybody's start line is different, dependent on various diverse characteristics, but we all deserve that opportunity to end or surpass at that finish line, and we shouldn't be subjected to anybody's biases to stop us from achieving that.
Brilliant. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you. Fantastic. And last but by no means least, Jagdeep.
Hi, I'm Jagdeep Soram, Head of Strategic Partnerships for the Multicultural Apprenticeship Alliance. It's an alliance compromising of a number of employers, FEHE type establishments, independent training providers. Ultimately, we're looking to promote social mobility, equity, diversity in apprenticeships and wider employability. We're built on three pillars: education, engagement, and advocacy and policy. So in terms of equity, it's really about creating a level playing field, you know, not dependent on people's sort of socioeconomic status, race, gender, or any other characteristic, protected or not. And it's about giving people an equal access to
that. Fantastic. Thank you. Thank you all very much. Well, let's see what you all had to say. Fairness was a big one that came up a lot, lots and lots of times. Fair treatment, fairness in terms of access to opportunity. We also have empathy, which has come up a lot, Juma, so you started a trend. Leveling the playing field, Jagdeep, we've got you there. Paying attention, belonging, bridging the gap, sharing gifts and talents, respect of individuality, leveling chances, mindless kindness, respect, transparency. That's a big one, and I think we're going to touch on that in our conversation. And acknowledging differences and being open to difference as well. So thank you for all your answers, those of you at home, and of course, all of you joining us today. Okay, so we are going to get cracking and begin with part one of our conversation. And in this piece of part of the conversation, we are going to be looking at what the current state of equity is in the workplace. Jemal, I'm going to begin with you, if I may. Organizations are struggling to attract talent and targeting underrepresented groups. Could you talk about this challenge in terms of the best way to tackle it and what the Open University found in their recent Business Barometer report?
Well, if I may, I'll talk about the Business Barometer first.
Yeah,
that we found.
Of course.
I suspect the actual experts on this panel will have something to say about what do we do to tackle it. So the university has been releasing its annual Business Barometer now for 7 years, 2 years in a row with the British Chambers of Commerce, which is where we talk often to over 1,200 organizations, small, large, medium-sized, and we look at what is happening in their talent space and the skills space. So unsurprisingly, this year as well, we found that over 70% of organizations are talking about skills shortages, facing skills shortages, and this rises to 86% when you start looking at the larger organizations. I pulled out a couple of other things that struck me in particular, and one of them was around the sort of hidden talent pools that organizations already have and how little is being done to tap into them, and yet we're talking about skills shortages. So a number of employers said that, you know, they were struggling to find applicants for the jobs. In fact, about 42% of them are struggling to fill the interviews that they're looking for candidates, sorry. And yet, and by hidden talent pools, you're talking about, you know, over 20, over 50s, under 25s, people with disabilities, talent from diverse background, veterans, people who may have caring responsibilities, who may have left care and might be thinking about how do they get in. And yet about 54% of organizations have no initiatives in place to address.
Are you serious?
Yes, the skills shortage. They have no workplace adjustments in place to look at this. And to me, this felt a little bit like low-hanging fruit. You know, it's right there in the report. We already have these people, and they have amazing skills, amazing life experiences that they can bring. If only we made some minor adjustments, you would be looking at higher loyalty, higher retention, higher performance. I was quite struck, actually, I was thinking about disability. So the university in particular has 37,000 disabled students every year. So we make it possible for them to study wherever they are, no matter what their circumstances
might
be. You've
been ahead of the curve with this.
We have been. I mean, we were set up to make education open for
accessible,
all. So the idea was, how do we make education possible? How do we bring education to the individual that wants to study? And we've always had, out of our 200,000 students, 37,000 this year have declared a disability. So it's huge. You know, an average university has 20,000 students. Our population of disabled students is nearly double that. So it's incumbent upon us to think about how do we do this. And as an employer too, if we're doing it, others can do it too.
Correct.
I'm not suggesting we get it right all of the time, but with intent, I think you can make a big difference. I'll pause there because I'm sure Gemmiel and others will have a view.
Brilliant, thank you. Thank you, Jemal. I'm gonna come to you, Rachel. And actually what Jemal said there really sort of is a perfect segue into my question for you. There seems to be a mismatch between employers looking to fill roles, but as Jemal said, not making the adjustments ahead of time to be able to attract diverse and new talent to their organizations. So in 2023, what are employees looking for from an employer?
So workers in 2023 are really looking for an increase in employee advocacy, and the millennials and Gen Z workers are really putting a high value on ESG, so environmental, social and governance. And actually Deloitte did a survey with millennials last year, and they found that nearly half of the employees in senior positions have turned down jobs because the organization didn't align with their values. And actually the survey also found that if the employees' efforts around DE&I were recognized, then over 50% of the people would actually stay in that opportunity for more than 5 years. So that's massive when we think about the focus that organisations can do for their staff retention. And when we kind of think about from an Ordelis perspective, we're actually finding that candidates are doing a lot more due diligence. So they're no longer just saying, oh my goodness, this is an amazing brand name, I want to work for them, or, you know, I'll compromise everything. And they're looking past the company's house. Actually, they're looking at, am I represented on the board? What does the senior leadership look like? What are the opportunities moving forward throughout this organization as well? And that's really key. So when we think about employers and what they can do, it's really for them to think about, what are we doing from a DE&I perspective? Yeah. Are we ensuring that our people are seen? Do we have a talent mobility program? And actually, one thing that we're seeing at the moment and is that a lot of organizations will have diverse employees at that entry level, but as the employees start to go throughout the organization, actually diversity just absolutely falls off a cliff. Yeah. So how can organizations work to improve that? And there's this piece about saying that if you're going to, what happens get measured. So if you're going to say you're going to do it, but really allow your employees and future employees to understand how they can be a part of that change.
Yes.
And make an impact on that business.
Because yeah. also when you have that level of transparency and communication with your workforce, then everybody feels a part of it. Because I think another area that we don't often look at is existing talent that may now feel overlooked or feel that they're not getting opportunities 100%. Because there's a focus on diversity and inclusion. So,
100%.
Yeah, love that. Thank you, Rachel. Okay, Gamil, I'm going to come to you. So how do employers start to identify the limitations of their current offering and what can they do to get started on their journey?
Well, you started the conversation by saying what gets measured or managed gets measured gets managed.
And done, yeah.
This is about data, but also it's about understanding where you are in terms of diversity, equity, and inclusion. Most organisations that come to us will say we are at the start of our journey, even though they've been on this journey for many, many years. But they're at the start of their journey because they've got no measurement. They don't know where they are.
Wow.
And really, the first part of any attempt to get things right within your organisation is to understand where you are.
Yeah.
And there's a free share here. There is a global diversity, equity and inclusion benchmark, which is an audit that you can download free, together with a maturity matrix, which is five different levels. And if you do that audit, what it will do is it won't benchmark you against any other organization. It will actually identify where you are on that maturity matrix, which is a starting point.
Mm-hmm.
And that way you can start to look at where the gaps are, look at what you need to do rather than, I talk about initiativitis. And initiativitis is literally moving from one initiative to another, rather than following a holistic approach to diversity, equity, and inclusion, where diversity is seen in every function. There is a project that we're doing with the V&A at the moment, or the Victoria and Albert Museum, and it's, you know, to me, it's moving the dial on diversity, equity, and inclusion. It's about developing function heads to actually start to consider writing their own diversity, equity, and inclusion strategies. So rather than the head
then
of
then they own it.
They
yeah.
own
to
it.
What Rachel was saying.
Yep.
Yeah.
They own it.
Yeah.
And also it's they get involved in writing it.
Yeah.
So who's the expert when it comes to comms? Is it head of diversity or is it the head of comms?
Yeah.
So really that inclusive, so they become, you know, inclusive communications, inclusive marketing, inclusive procurement, etc.
Yeah.
So that's a starting point.
Yeah, and they know their departments.
Absolutely.
Yeah, love it, fantastic. So Jagdeep, obviously your organisation looks at what employers can do to support young and diverse apprentices in the workplace, and back to Rachel again, she's touched on the social attitudes of this generation. You highlighted inequity of opportunity. Can you tell me what you mean by that?
Yeah, sure. So in the context of organisations' focus on supporting young, diverse apprenticeships, workplace. In terms of the term inequity of opportunity refers to the existence of an equal and unfair access to opportunities for individuals, and that's based on their background, socioeconomic issues, their circumstances, protected characteristics or not. And it can manifest in many ways. So I've sort of got a list of areas that we've, so through our Festival of Apprenticeships that we have, we run three careers fairs.
Yeah.
We do some sort of post research on that and post surveys. And some of the areas and issues that have come about that is one around sort of accessibility of opportunities. So some young diverse apprentices may have limited access to these opportunities. Career advancement opportunities if they have got an apprenticeship, and it's all around that sort of attraction engagement piece as well.
Yeah,
which is quite clear. So that mentorship and support, I think we've touched on that in the panel. So once they are in work, so certain individuals may receive less mentorship, and that's really important. That sort of on the job training, the culture of the workplace. So that's a real big key. So an organisational culture that may not be inclusive. And that may make it harder for young, diverse apprentices to feel welcomed.
Fantastic.
And then areas such as their pays and benefits and progression rates. And then I think, you know, Rachel touched on that sort of role models. There's a real lack of role models and mentors within the apprenticeship space,
yeah.
Particularly from that sort of multicultural space that we need to sort of increase on.
Yeah.
Societal background and demographic. So again, that inequity of opportunity, you know, you have the north-south divide, there's, and also the sector
yes.
divide as well.
Mm-hmm.
So where are these opportunities? And opportunities for those from a lower socioeconomic
yeah.
background. And there's also disparity in apprenticeship levels as well. So there's a lot of talk about degree apprenticeships. You know, you could be an accountant, you could be a doctor, you could be a solicitor, et cetera, et cetera. And I think there's a cohort that sort of Lucy Hunt, who's on the panel a bit later, may talk about a cohort of those that have got less education attainment that are in real danger of missing out and falling out of the system because of sort of the systematic issues within the apprenticeship
yeah.
space. However, that's something that needs to be looked at. And there's a large cohort with that because I think the degree apprentices may be fine. They'll be okay if they don't get an apprenticeship degree, they'll get a job elsewhere.
Yeah.
But it's that real sort of inequity of opportunity for the lower
more vocational.
Vocational yeah. That are danger of missing out.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. Thank you, Jagdeep. So I'm going to open the discussion up to all of you, if I may. And what we'd love to know is, are there other barriers that perhaps have not even been mentioned yet on our panel? And are there unseen barriers that you've all experienced or you are aware of when it comes to joining an organization? So please use the Slido to be able to answer those questions for us. So yeah, use your Slido. Any other barriers that you think we haven't touched on? Anything else our panel wants to add while that's coming in?
Sorry, excuse me.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd just like just to briefly talk about what we know as hidden and shadow cultures within organisations.
Yes.
And, you know, we've been involved in 46 pieces of research
wow.
around the perceptions of minority groups towards employers, but also the reality of working for those employers
yep.
from a minoritised perspective. And every piece of research that we've done has always highlighted this explicit culture,
yeah.
how senior leaders see an organisation, which, if you look at their annual reports, their websites and everything else, is really positive.
Mm.
But then when you start talking to minoritised groups, you start to hear
something very different.
Totally different.
Yeah.
And that's the hidden and shadow culture
mm.
that exists in every organisation.
Yeah.
We just need to find, we just need to communicate, get to know our staff
mm.
better, but also our communities
yeah.
so much better.
Totally. Does anyone want to add to that? Because I saw you all nodding.
So I was actually just going to talk about the application process
mm.
as well. And we often find that diverse applicants don't necessarily apply to jobs online. So if you ever collect data of what the diversity is of any of your roles that you've advertised, there's probably a high chance that the diversity has dropped. So there's a piece around making sure that it is accessible and it is inclusive. So that goes beyond the language that you're using. But it's also thinking that we're now living in this world where AI is slowly going to take over, but just don't rely on AI to do your job descriptions and your advertisement, because there are biases that go into that that aren't going to capture everything. So it's just being very aware of everything that you're doing.
Brilliant. Jamal?
I was going to stay with something I'd mentioned earlier, actually, but perhaps your audience might like to hazard a guess first. What is the world's largest minority? One in eight of us.
Pardon?
One in eight of us has a disability. Yes. The world's largest minority are people with a disability. So about 15% of the world's population.
Yeah.
70% of disabilities are hidden,
yeah,
often not declared.
Yeah.
And half of that 15% are not likely to get a job.
It's terrible.
That tells you something. And I then thought, okay, what happens in the UK? And here's one example. 75% of FTSE 100 companies are not even accessibility compliant on their websites. I don't have to say much more because the audience will pick,
wow,
how this links. If your website is not accessibility compliant, you can start to see what's happening to your customers, what's happening to those that might be considering your company from a recruitment perspective, and the talent that hasn't even reached you that you're losing. This lack of accessibility equates to £120 million of revenue lost every year.
Madness, isn't it?
Let alone the talent and the potential that is lost. So I think it really is important for us all to think about those pools of people, where they are, how do we attract them? And how do we make it easy for an individual to connect with us in the first instance,
yeah,
let alone when they're with us and then,
yeah,
what happens with,
yeah,
them and what our culture does and all of those,
yeah,
sorts of things. But even at the first space where they think, I'd like to work for this company,
yeah,
we're failing them.
Totally. And to that point, Jamal, the disabled community is one that any of us could join at any time. And particularly with an aging population, we live long enough, chances are we're probably going to be part of that group. So it's madness that we so exclude them in our societies. Yeah. Jagdeep, you wanted to add something from a youth perspective?
Yeah, I think, you know, the esteemed sort of panel members have touched a lot of the sort of areas that I was going to speak about. You know, we sort of touch a lot on sort of the nuances within the Multicultural Apprenticeship Alliance that that, you know, young diverse apprentices can face. So, you know, that neurodiversity, that culture, that sort of progression route as well. But in terms of sort of that attraction and education on what an apprenticeship is, or where that access of opportunity is, I think that's a real sort of area that we need to focus on. So make the aspirational individual be aware of where these opportunities are, and making it as easy as possible,
yeah,
for them to access these opportunities as well.
Totally. So. Brilliant. Thank you. Okay. Thank you, panel. So we are now going to move to part two of our conversation. And here we're going to focus on removing the barriers. Gamil, I'm going to come to you first, if I may. So what can employers do to remove these barriers? We've touched on it a bit in the previous conversations, but I'd love you to sort of dig deeper, if you may. And what are the barriers that are preventing diverse talent from joining an organization? And obviously, the initiatives that are working and not working. And literally, we just want you to tell us what to do.
Yeah. Okay, well, firstly, every single organization is different.
Of course.
And culture plays probably the biggest part of, you know, whether people stay, whether they want to join you, or whether they feel that they can progress in an organization.
Yeah.
And, you know, the first step is find out what your staff think. Yeah. Again, go back to those hidden and shadow cultures and find out what they are, because every organization will experience them differently. So, you know, run focus groups, do I mean, one thing that we've been doing lately so much of is using webinars, but also interactive webinars. So using Slido or using Mentimeter, and literally because they're anonymous, you can, you know, the most we've had on one was 187.
Wow.
And you get masses and masses of feedback that you can collate, you know, and you can collect all of that and then start doing something with it. That's key, because for years and years and years, many organizations have, you know, run their focus groups and found out what's happening in their organizations, but have they truly identified the problem and dealt with the problem? Mm. We've had positive action initiatives since 2000, but if we looked at the number of take up on positive action initiatives, so really it's about doing something with the information that we have, and that could be something like a positive action pathway or a Beyond Boundaries program that the civil service run. And what that's aimed at is minoritized groups that haven't progressed at the same rates as their white counterparts, and then introduce the program to help them navigate the system.
Yeah.
And you navigate the system by increasing your knowledge, by gaining confidence, by understanding how to do some things that certain groups find easy to do, or have the opportunity to do, like networking at various levels within organizations. Yeah. How do you encourage somebody that has never really been complimented in the organization to join a network of, you know, that they have no confidence in terms of relating to, or those cultural differences that exist? But this is where sponsorship, mentorship really does
play
an impact. And that's about senior leaders and middle managers actually creating that psychological safety for anybody from any background to actually participate. And that's the equity piece.
Brilliant, fantastic, thank you. So Rachel, I'm gonna come to you next. So some organizations that are watching today might be thinking that they've made some steps already towards creating a more equitable workplace, you know, unconscious bias training and, you know, all of that malarkey. In terms of recruitment processes and sort of removing biases through the recruitment process itself, is that really enough? Is it working?
So it's a starting block.
Mm, okay.
It can be a step in the right direction, but it isn't enough.
I like how nicely you said that.
Well, yeah. And I think that psychological safety that you mentioned is really important.
Yeah.
But actually, it's what you do next that is absolutely key.
Mm.
So what are you doing with the training? What are you doing with the processes that have been put in place? How are you implementing these operationally into your organisation? And actually, how is this going to benefit your diverse employees? So we've seen the rise of employee resource groups, so ERGs. And if you think about your organisation, do they have a voice? Can they actually impact on the policies that are happening within your organisation? Are you actually going to the ERGs and speaking to them to understand what is their lived experience outside of work, but also within the workplace? And how can you create that psychological safety and a truly inclusive environment where everybody can belong as well?
Yep.
So really listening to your diverse employees, using role models and using those ERGs to really further how you can become more inclusive. But there's also this piece around setting targets or objectives. So depending on the organisation, some like to use the word targets, some don't. They think that's a bit aggressive, so they use objectives. But actually, this allows you to monitor how diversity goes through the funnel. And it allows you to make an informed decision then and identify where the challenges are.
Yeah.
So we've actually seen that some clients are now starting to mandate the search firms and recruitment firms that they work with to say we need to ensure diversity for our shortlist. If diversity isn't represented at the shortlist, go back, find diversity, make sure it's balanced, or there's a penalty fee there as well. And past this in recruitment, we know that specifically, it's useful to assess how you're appointing your new employees as well, and to see if they're carrying out a truly fair process. So within Old Dulles, we really advocate for this inclusive recruitment process. We take all of our clients through it from briefing until the ending as well. And that's looking at things like the role profile, it's defining what the hiring process is, it's ensuring there's absolute consistency across, it's being open-minded. And then all because you've then appointed that diverse person doesn't mean that you're then going to keep them. The work continues. So actually, what is their onboarding? Do they feel included? Do they feel a sense of belonging? Because if they don't, they're going to go. And actually, when we think about this fixed idea of experience, we'll really challenge, but what does that look like? Because a lot of the time, hiring managers want to hire in their own image. So if they've been to a red brick university, they'll say, must come from a red brick university, have X amount of experience. But actually, by doing that, you're just dissecting the amount of diversity that you can have. And I really feel that you should be hiring a person who answers the question that you're asking. And rather than looking at perhaps where somebody started their career, so is it through a degree apprenticeship? Is it through, you know, leaving school without GCSEs, but they've gone straight into the apprenticeship? Actually, we should be focusing on what have they done? What value have they added to their organisations? What impact? And actually, how can they help us further our organisation, rather than looking at things that are outside of their control as well?
Brilliant. Thank you, Rachel. Jamal, before I come to you, I want to open up our poll to our audience, obviously our live audience and our online audience too. So the poll question is, could your organisation be doing more to attract diverse talent? Could your organisation be doing more to attract diverse talent? If you can answer that on the Slido, I will come back shortly with the results. So Jamal, I'm going to come to you. So the Open University, as you mentioned earlier, work with a number of employers to help provide learning and development opportunities and tools to their employees. Can you give us any insights into what you're doing as an employer and what you do well?
Thank you. Well is subjective. But we're doing our best.
Yeah.
So I think we've all mentioned how important it is to be deliberate and intentional.
Yeah.
So for us, that started when we were starting to write our five-year strategy. So we're in year one of that five-year strategy. And greater equity in everything that we do and achieve is written into it as one of the five strategic goals for the organization.
Yep.
That means it gets looked at regularly by the leadership. We track everything. We gather data. The gathering data bit is where I think it might be a little bit subjective sometimes, but it's part of the fabric of the organization at a very, very senior level.
Yep.
So it then filters down. For example, I lead a small unit in the organization. It filters down into my five-year unit planning. So all of us have annual planning cycles. In that annual planning document, there is a question around our commitment to EDI and what are the specific initiatives we, as a tiny little unit, will take. That applies across the whole organization to all units. And that's where you have freedom to make it relevant.
Mm.
It's not just a top-down diktat. Yep. We decide in the development office, for example, which is all about fundraising and communicating with our alumni, how does EDI show up? Where do we show diversity? We're also a team, and this is something that I've come across a lot. We're also an organization that cares and an organization that people tend to stay with. Mm. So recruitment becomes less of a solution for us because people tend to stay with this organization.
Oh, wow.
How do you then say recruitment is one of our measures when actually in my department, for example, turnover is incredibly low. People don't leave.
Mm.
We grow our own. That's the other thing. So people don't leave because they've got a lot of opportunity in that team.
Yeah.
So we've had to think about how do we do equality and diversity in slightly more creative ways in our communications, for example. So I think that's the senior level buy-in, the strategic buy-in is very important. And then you've mentioned staff networks, so I won't. We've got them too. I think we could be better at how we converse with our staff networks and the opportunities we provide and for them to feed into the organization. But it doesn't mean that the intent isn't there and the communities they represent. I think in hiring terms, there have been some interesting shifts for us. So all our hiring managers, you if you're going to be on a recruitment panel, you have to have had appropriate training.
Right.
And all hiring managers are encouraged to seek data for the unit that they're hiring into, so that you can then see what does the diversity portfolio look like within that unit. So that sort of local lens, what is going on, therefore, how do we then write, how do we speak, what is going on? And then the panel that is composed must also be diverse. We're also trying out anonymous shortlisting. So lots of things, I think, to sort of look at, you know, what could we do? How do we show up? And how do we then make it a sustained process for a large organization of 11,000 employees so that this becomes part of our DNA?
Yeah, brilliant. Thank you. So Jagdeep, can you tell us about apprenticeships and work-based learning and why they can be more attractive for diverse groups, but also how they can be made even more accessible and equitable?
Yeah, sure. So apprenticeships and work-based learning, they're educational and training programs that combine sort of classroom instruction and sort of practical on the job experience. What we at the Multicultural Apprenticeship Alliance, we want apprenticeships to be a credible and equitable alternative to further education and higher education. And with sort of the current sort of or recent government rhetoric from the Prime Minister, the government are also looking to push apprenticeships as well, which is great news. So the more we can highlight what apprenticeships and the benefits of apprenticeships, that's great, particularly from a higher level, and hopefully the government will invest more in that as well. So in terms of sort of why they can be more attractive routes to underrepresented individuals, so it actually provides that hands-on experience. So apprenticeships and work-based learning, so they offer that real hands-on experience and that real sort of on-the-job training. You actually earn while you learn, so you know, you're actually receiving a wage rather than going to university or higher education when you generally come out with a poorer bank balance than you went in with. There's that real industry recognition as well, so you actually get that experience and that those skills while you're actually learning. So that's really attractive to an employer as well. And it's a tailored career pathway, so your first apprenticeship may not be the career, but it's sort of starting you off to a tailored career pathway, and it's giving you that structure and that context in terms of the working model is. And employer investment. So employers are really invested. Those that really focus on apprenticeships, they're really invested in what an apprenticeship is at whatever level. And I know in terms of the patrons of the Multicultural Apprenticeship Alliance, they're really committed to apprenticeships and increasing their diversity and inclusion within their workforce. Mm. So they're brought into that. In terms of sort of making apprenticeships even more equitable, so I think there's that real piece around sort of education and engagement, and as I mentioned before, that's two of the three pillars that the Alliance, the Multicultural Apprenticeship Alliance, is built on. So we really, really need to increase that engagement and that knowledge base for underrepresented groups and communities and all the stakeholders involved within that. There's a big piece around sort of addressing biases and barriers and dispelling myths. So identify and eliminate the biases in sort of, I know we've touched on recruitment and selection processes, but actually applying and getting through an apprenticeship application is very tough. I know one of our sort of our multicultural apprenticeship awards winners, who works for one of the sort of the big four accountancy firms, he had competition from over 4,000 individuals going for one apprenticeship opportunity.
What?
So you can see sort of the competition in there. But this is the sort of the high level apprenticeship.
Yeah.
And with an organization that has the infrastructure to be able to provide that sort of support and that recruitment process. I think we need sort of that diverse employer participation, and I think that's all that means sort of sectorial as well as geographical. So encourage a diverse range of employers to participate in apprenticeship programs as well. And that's easier said than done. Mentorship and support, so as we mentioned, sort of on-the-job training, off-the-job training, and providing that opportunity to be able to really fulfill their aspirations in apprenticeship and providing them with the access to that and the full time for that, and building sort of that role model, role models as well. Flexible pathways, so designing the apprenticeship programs with flexible options, And data collection and evaluation is really, really important as well. So what works, what doesn't work, and actually having that data, that science behind it, that you can present to various stakeholders.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. So, well, our results are in for our poll. And unsurprisingly, the results are not surprising at all. So the question was, could your organization be doing more to attract diverse talent? 92% of you said yes. 7% said not sure, and 2% said no. So I think it really just sums up everything that our panel's been saying, in that organizations need to do more and must do more. So we're coming towards the end. We've got not too long to go. I think we've got about 12 minutes. So what I'd love to do is be able to answer some of the questions that have come in. So I'm going to ask them, and then, you know, I'll direct them accordingly, but obviously chip in as well. So we have a question from Pauline, and she said, my son is dyslexic and struggles with interviews and written tests. Does the panel feel lack of understanding of EDI is driving away talent? Anyone want to answer that? Mill? Yeah?
As someone that's been diagnosed with dyslexia 3 months ago.
Wow.
I know that the system, we talk about broken system.
Yeah.
The system doesn't really exist. There is so much. And if I go from my experience, I know that firstly, you don't know what you don't know.
Mm.
And that's the biggest challenge that I've had.
Yeah.
Is not knowing, you know, what to do, what I should do differently.
Mm.
But just with certain adaptations, you know, I actually think I'm performing double the rate that I was before I was diagnosed.
Wow.
And one of the biggest
issues.
Because
now you know what it is.
Absolutely. Yeah. And some of those interventions, but you know, we assume that we know how to support somebody with dyslexia. But as you know, dyslexia, like most neurodivergent challenges, are a spectrum.
Yeah.
And it's about the individual. Understanding the individual. But one thing I'd also like to add is that so many organizations are doing great stuff. 37,000, you know, disabled you know, students, the learning that you have from that, the reasonable adjustments you've put in place, the workplace assessments, the real brilliant practice that you're doing on a daily basis. Are you and this isn't a criticism of the OU, of most organizations, are we shouting about that stuff? Is all of that good practice on our websites? Are we talking about it? I know that most organizations aren't, and we need to raise awareness.
Yeah.
Because once we start talking about the good stuff.
Yes, as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. Then we engage those who are disengaged.
Brilliant, fantastic, thank you.
Can I just add?
Yes, please, go on.
There's also this piece about breaking down the barriers and avoiding the stigma around dyslexia. So for Pauline's son, for him to actually reach out to the employer and say, I'm dyslexic, you haven't made your application process accessible, what can you do? Is one way to try and push that, and actually then it's up to the organisation to say, hopefully, thank you, this is how we can create an inclusive recruitment process too.
Brilliant, yeah. Jagdeep, I'm going to ask you this question. Questions come in, do you feel that there aren't enough entry-level apprenticeships?
I think we can always improve. I think there's a real, for sort of entry-level roles, there's a real sort of for organisations and individuals in terms of attracting underrepresented aspiring apprentices. I think there's a real lack of knowledge. I think sort of in terms of the whole stakeholder base, I think that needs to be improved. And also to the employer as well, I think their sort of knowledge of what an apprenticeship is and what levels that they can actually go into, that needs to be improved as well. We can always do more, and that's what the Multicultural Apprenticeship Alliance is actually doing, is trying to increase the knowledge and awareness of what an apprenticeship is and what the benefits of an apprenticeship is. So that in short, the answer is yes, very much so.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to ask you this one, Jumar. Georgina has asked, how can flexible working be leveraged, especially for those with caring responsibilities at home?
I think it begins with something Gamil said, but we've all sort of referred to it, really. It's asking people rather than assuming you know better. It's asking people, what do they require? What is it that the adjustment, what kind of adjustments can be put into place? I'm thinking of a couple of my colleagues, for example. You don't need to know the detail of what somebody's life encompasses, but you do need to know what they need from you as an employer, where they spend 8, 10, sometimes more time, hours in a day, because you bring, I believe, your whole self to work. It's very difficult, and I admire people who can do that, but I most certainly don't switch off who I am at home, being a parent, not thinking about my child. Even now I'm thinking, is he still alive? He's been awake for an hour, yeah. He's 10. Yeah. you don't switch that off and then come to work. You carry your broken boiler, your caring responsibilities with you, yeah, to work. And on some days, when you're not having a good day, you need somebody to say, go home and get the boiler fixed.
Yes. Yeah.
It's okay, you know, nothing other than being a doctor or being in the ER is life or death.
Yeah.
So if it's not life or death, then life has to come first. Mm-hmm. And your life sometimes might be back home. So I think it's really important to talk to people, to ask them what they need, and to create, you know, you talked about psychological safety. Most people talk about it now. Most people don't know what that actually means, and most people definitely don't know how to create it. But how do you keep that safety where somebody can come and say, I'm dyslexic? Georgina can talk about the issues that she might be having in her life, and then say, here's what I need. Mm. And the reciprocal to that is trust. You know, you have to, we've just come out of a pandemic where we were all sent home and told work from home, and suddenly we all seemed to trust each other because it became about life or death. And we didn't talk about productivity for the best part of 18 months. We just got on with the job that had to be done, and we trusted everybody who was in our workforce to be doing the work that needed to be done. And quite frankly,
they did.
Companies didn't fall over.
Yeah.
And the world continued. Yeah. So there is something about trust and understanding that people will always give you your best if you give them yours. Mm.
Brilliant. Rachel, I'm going to ask you the last one from the audience. How does access to networks hold back underrepresented groups, or lack of access to networks?
Yeah, I think when we think about networks, it's having, again, we talk about psychological safety, but a group of people within an organisation who understand your lived experience and hopefully can vouch for you as well. And I'd probably say that if your organisation doesn't have a network, then be the change, be the person to set that up. Speak to, you know, the HR department, your DE&I, a trusted senior, somebody who's had your back, and just talk to them about what you think can happen if you create this network. But also, it's we go into mentoring and sponsorship, and what else can come out of that as well. So having that person to be your voice and work with is going to be important.
Fantastic, thank you. Can we have the time back on the screen? So I know, great, okay, 6 minutes, guys, not long. So takeaways, it'd be good to just get from all of you, I think just a quick sort of takeaway that you want to leave the audience with. Jagdeep, I'm going to start with you because I've been coming to you last all the time. So let me come to you first. What's the takeaway for our audience?
So one of the takeaways really is an employment's brand is really, really critical in the perception of individuals and what the employer brand is. And that brand has to really have that commitment to diversity, inclusion, and equity, and reducing inequity of opportunity. And that's really what so we're working to strive for in terms of the Multicultural Apprenticeship Alliance. The commitment that our patrons show is that real sort of commitment,
yeah,
to promoting social mobility, equity, and diversity. I just really want to finish with sort of a paragraph really that I picked up only yesterday, and it's about how connectable and inclusion drive business success. So the power of equity, diversity, and inclusion is more than just a feel-good initiative. It's a strategy imperative that fuels innovation, enhances decision-making processes, and drives competitive advantage. The figures speak for themselves, so there's some science behind this as well. So according to Deloitte, organizations with equitable and inclusive cultures were twice as likely to succeed their financial targets.
Look at that. It's good for the bottom line. How about that? As well as being the right thing to do. Rachel?
So go back to what we said before about what gets measured gets done. So I always say that data is absolutely royal. If you understand what's happening within your organisation, then you can put the measures in place to do something. So if we look at, for instance, the FTSE 350, the FTSE Women Leaders put a target in place to have 40% gender representation on boards by 2025. They hit that 3 years early, now they just need to maintain it. When we think about the Parker Review, they put an objective out for FTSE boards to have one ethnically diverse person on their board. 96 of the FTSE 100 companies have now done that, where in 2016 that was at 47. So if you put the measurement there and then make sure that you're consistent, and then it gets done.
Brilliant, thank you. Jamal?
I think doing nothing is not an option anymore. I was quite intrigued by that 2% who said doing nothing. I'd love to find out a bit more about that. I think for every business, we measure risk. You know, there's supply chain risk, procurement, inflation, all sorts of issues. I think lack of diversity needs to become a risk on the risk register. Mm. You will then measure it, you will then report on it, and you will track it just as you track your bottom line.
Ooh, love that. Yeah. That's a mic drop moment, that is. Camille?
So my takeaway is most of the solutions to help any organisation drive diversity, equity and inclusion is either within your organisation or in the communities that surround your organisation. You know, if we take Milton Keynes as an example, Milton Keynes has 10 mosques, two gurdwaras, three temples, soon to be four temples, you know, probably 80 black churches. And these aren't static churches. You know, most congregations meet in community centres on a Sunday morning. Mm. So to try and find a community centre on a Sunday morning in Milton Keynes is almost impossible. Hugely diverse. We've gone from 6% in 1991 to 13% in 2001 to 26% in 2011 to approximately 38% in the last census. So that was 3 years ago. So you're looking at 40% of our population are from different minoritized groups.
Wow.
And you know, that is talent. There is talent everywhere. If you go and talk to a taxi driver at Milton Keynes Station, you will find that probably 30% of those taxi drivers are well qualified, have qualifications from their own, from the countries that they come from. They will have experience.
Yep.
But how many of those taxi drivers have we ever spoken to? And this comes back to branding and something you mentioned earlier. You know, most people know the brands of organizations, but they will not, and again, we've researched this so much, they'll know the brand, but they will not know the employer brand. So in terms of your employer, you know...
What do you mean by that?
By employer brand, in terms of what roles are available within the organization, what career paths are available.
Yeah.
And you know, and that's the employer brand.
And what it takes to make whatever product it is that they're buying, and how they could be part of that.
Yes.
Yeah. It's true, it's such a good point. You know, obviously my background's television and before that music industry. And people always only think about the talent on screen or the singer that's singing. But actually there's such a big ecosystem around that. You can still be an accountant in a record company. So oh my goodness, we have hit the time. Time flies when you're having fun. Can we have a round of applause for our fantastic panel? Thank you all so much for joining us. To everybody at home, we will be back at 11:30 on the dot with our second panel. Bye, everyone. Thank you.